Hi guys, Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive. I'm sat with Tom Quayle, and we're taking a look at two fabulous Martin guitars. We've got the OM28 from the Modern Deluxe series.
Yes.
This is the Junior Dreadnought. Mm-hmm. Now, we've each reviewed one of these guitars. I got to look at this lovely shiny beast. Tom took a look at this petite but lovely little Dreadnought guitar. So we thought we'd swap and we'd sort of discuss our experiences, just kind of take a second look at these. As is often the way, we like to take a second look at these guitars before they have to go back to the to Martin. So, you know, we really don't want to let them go.
No.
Especially this one.
It's beautiful.
Having said that, I've been having a lot of fun playing this one. You know, it's the first time I've laid my hands on it. It's a lovely thing. Let's start by talking about what they are for anybody who might miss the reviews. Do you want to tell me a bit about this one, Tom?
Yeah, so the Dreadnought Junior is obviously a small-bodied, as they say, junior dreadnought shape. So it is a dreadnought shape. The thing with this guitar is compared to a really high-end Martin, high-end in terms of price, because all Martins play and sound good. This guitar sounds great. They've kept the cost down because they've got sapel back in size as opposed to mahogany or rosewood, for instance, which is an affordable version of mahogany. It does have a solid Sitka spruce top, which is quite impressive.
Well, that's cool.
So you're getting that kind of whole vibe of it will age well and sound better the more you play it, all that kind of thing. But it's finished in satin, so you've not got kind of the gloss that's going on with this guitar. So it doesn't look blingy. It's got a very kind of simple rosette and stuff. Sapel neck, it's not mahogany again. But considering its size and considering that it's made of sort of, if you like, I hate using this word, but cheaper materials, more budget-friendly materials, it does actually sound really good and plays great because it's got a shorter scale length. So it makes it more approachable. I've actually got quite small hands and that guitar plays really nicely. You know, action's low enough, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
It's got quality die-cast tuners on it. You know, nothing fancy, but for what you pay for it, especially considering this actually comes with a really nice Martin gig bag as well. So,
that's cool.
You know, it's a good guitar. It's got electronics built in. There's a Fishman. I think it's a Sonitone in there, but I can't remember because it was a few weeks ago that I reviewed it. But there's a Fishman preamp in there of some description. There's an output jack on the bottom here and 9-volt battery, all the usual stuff. And what's actually really nice in terms of, you know, the what is it kind of vibe, the electronics are actually hidden away in here. Because one thing that I really don't like, it's just a personal peeve.
The big
When you've got the giant preamp on the top there and all the controls.
Why would you cut a massive hole in your lovely, in the side of your lovely guitar?
Exactly, because the guitars look nice. They've got all these kind of sexy curves going on and stuff. They look really cool. The woods are really nice. And again, it's satin, but I like a satin finish. And then someone drills a big hole out of there and sticks a giant preamp in there. It's just nice. So you've got a tone control and a volume control.
Yeah.
Dead easy to use.
Man, works for me. And it's I'm guessing they're passive as well. So there's not a whole lot to fiddle around with. That's something that I have a bit of a quibble with at lower price points is these really all sing all dancing preamps. And I've discussed this actually in a column in GI about dialing your acoustic tone.
Right.
I really don't think giving loads of options to the kind of player who's going to buy this guitar is a great idea because it's very easy to get it wrong.
Yeah.
And we've all done that. You know, we've all gone, oh, I want more high end. I want to take all the mids out. And then suddenly you're left with ice picky nastiness.
Yep.
I do like the satin finish. I'm with you on that. It kind of has there's pros and cons to it. I really like the idea that you can get kind of a brushy kind of sound on this, but when you're recording with the mic, it can be a bit.
Yeah, also it will get mucky over time as well. You need to clean gloss guitars as well, but this will actually change colour as you're playing.
Yeah.
If you're a guy who, you know, comes over the top a lot and is hitting it and stuff, this will obviously become damaged more quickly. But then the price of the guitar reflects that, and you shouldn't be so worried about that with a guitar like this.
Yeah, I think it'll probably actually look quite cool when it's starting to
absolutely to
go down the Willie Nelson kind of road.
Absolutely.
But I'm a big fan of this, you know, like I say, as primarily an electric player. I like the short scale. The neck is very comfortable.
It almost
feels like the string spacing's a little narrower.
It could well be.
I don't know if it is. I don't know if it's just because the neck's comfortable.
Yeah.
And I'm expecting it to feel narrower, but feels like a great guitar. You know, I've really, really enjoyed playing it. I tend to like smaller bodied acoustics anyway.
Me too,
It's like, again, this is sort of coming from playing smaller, more petite instruments. You know, I'm a PRS guy, so they're quite small guitars anyway. Even though I'm quite a big dude, I quite like the feel of holding a small guitar. And this one's quite nice as well for that. It's not enormous.
There's actually a marked difference in terms of the weight between these two as well, which is something that I hadn't expected. This is an incredibly, I mean, unbelievably light guitar. The body is incredibly light.
Now, there's some things that have kind of influenced that. So the body is light, and it's quite a thin top, but it's quite stiffly braced. Yeah. But the interesting thing they've done to keep the weight down, I should preface this by saying that the Modern Deluxe series is kind of Martin's new top-end production guitar. Yeah. So it's before you get to the custom shop.
It's still a very expensive guitar.
Oh my goodness, yeah. It's, you could probably get, if I had to estimate, 8 or 10 of these for the price of one of these.
Yeah.
Not that you could play 8 or 10 of them, but
no, I
who
couldn't
knows?
Anyway.
Yeah, I'd have a go.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, it's got a bunch of clever features. Probably the biggest one for the weight is the new slim neck and the titanium truss rod.
Right.
So because the body's very light, if you had a really heavy, thick neck on it, it would be very neck divey.
Yeah.
It's not such a problem with the OM shape because it's quite curvy. So you've got a real solid place to put your leg.
Yes. Very comfortable.
Yeah. It's very kind of anchors you in place. But at the same time, neck dive on acoustic guitars is not fun. This one's got a little bit of it going on, but not a whole lot. You know, I've definitely felt worse. But it is really light, even though it's a bigger guitar. And I think that kind of contributes to the airy nature of the tone, maybe. It's got a kind of a silky thing going on that I really like.
Yeah. It covers all the frequency range really, really nicely. You were mentioning something as well about carbon fiber under here, and there's all sorts of little interesting touches, like the frets, the carbon fiber. You mentioned something about liquid metal or something in the review.
Apparently, yeah.
That's an interesting thing.
Liquid metal. I couldn't actually find any more information about that. It's just a specific type of bridge pin that Martin have used, but if anything, it just goes to show the level of detail that's been, the attention to detail that's been put into making this guitar what it is. And it's such a departure from the vintage series that it's replaced, because the vintage series were like ostensibly like old style Martin guitars. This is very much a modern guitar for the modern player, but it doesn't look or necessarily feel very modern. It feels like an old guitar, but it's just full of clever tech that makes it
work. I was going to say, if you're going to buy a guitar for this much money and you're not buying a vintage guitar, or one that is ostensibly a vintage that's made recently, I think you want some R&D to go into the guitar to make it more modern, more playable, tonally more kind of, if you like, you know, more consistent, so on and so forth. So Martin have obviously gone to town here in terms of, again, the frets. I mean, tell me a little bit about the frets.
So the frets are, so we're both big fans of stainless steel frets on electric guitars. It's been well documented. Sorry, Paul. I know Paul Reed Smith doesn't like them at all. I love them. I have them in a bunch of mine. Horses for courses, but I really like them for the reason that they're a bit harder.
Yeah.
And the guy who installs mine actually told me that apparently they tend to make the guitar louder and project a little harder.
Now that I didn't know, right.
Apparently it's because they're less absorptive. So they don't absorb as much vibration from
the
string.
That makes sense. Because they're harder, so they don't actually...
Yeah, which makes perfect sense to me. These are... Martin called them Evo frets. So it's basically a new alloy that's kind of...
Steve, I might have something to say about
that. I was going to say, it's a copyright infringement.
Absolutely.
But, you know, when we see them on the new gems, who knows? But, what they basically are is they're kind of a copper-infused fret.
Yeah.
And they're harder... on the hardness scale, the Mohs hardness scale, harder than your typical nickel steel fret that you find in a guitar like this.
But are they less hard than stainless steel? Are they in between somewhere?
I'm guessing they are.
Right.
I remember, you know, we were invited to the press conference at NAMM this year, and that was the impression that I was given, that they're a little harder, but not so hard as to be... Because it might be a little zingy on an old school guitar to put stainless steel frets in.
Absolutely.
But the other thing, with them being slightly gold colored, there's no gold in there. Gold's a very soft metal, but the copper gives them this gold hue, which matches the tuners, which I think is sort of...
They're not
of the
obscenely gold, though. I mean, they do have a silver element to them, because I think you'd be a bit worried seeing a guitar like this that has a slightly more vintage look with bright, you know, discolored frets would be slightly off-putting.
Yeah.
They do have a gold tint to them, but they're not, you know, they still look kind of... silvery in a way as well.
Yeah, they don't look kind of like they look more brass than anything to me. But they're nice looking frets, they feel good, and they should, in theory, last a lot longer because you've got this lovely ebony fretboard.
Yes.
The other thing with this is it's a small point, but the fretboard is quite slim. Mm. And they've had to do that again because the neck profile is quite slim. And they based this on a 1930s guitar they had kicking around in the factory. Now, the issue with this, of course, just kicking around, but it is the Martin factory.
If you're going to find one, you'd imagine.
And, you know, like, you know, 1930s is like, you know, practically youthful. It's practically infant by Martin standards. So they've had to use this slim fretboard. Now, what that does is it limits the number of times the guitar can be refretted. So assuming this guitar is going to live as long as some of the old Martin guitars did, you know, the ones from like the 1800s, for example, and there's no reason why it wouldn't.
No,
this is a guitar for several lifetimes. It's an heirloom quality instrument.
Absolutely.
You don't want to be refretting this guitar so many times
really
with this
point.
Slim fretboard
wears
through. So those frets should help with that, I'd imagine.
I think they've struck a really nice balance. I mean, I've only just played this guitar for the jam that we did, but I think they've struck a really nice balance between vintage good looks, if you like, you know, things like the open gear tuners on the back, the volute on the headstock.
Yeah, it's lovely.
The kind of slightly smaller body size and curves, but with modern appointments, like the carbon fiber and so on and so forth, and, you know, the frets and stuff. I think it's a really nice balance because you can get shifted too far the other way. I think all guitar players have a little bit of love for a vintage-y kind of looking instrument.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
But those inconsistencies that you get can be a problem from a professional kind of playing point of view.
Definitely.
You know, and if you spend this much money on a guitar, it's like I was saying before, if you're not going for a vintage instrument because it's vintage and because it's got the vibe, you want something that's precise, modern, consistent, and I think they've struck a really good balance.
I think so too. It's very much for the pro player, but
yes.
The great thing about it is it's not going to stand out in a professional environment as a modern guitar.
Yeah.
So, you know, let's say you're playing with a band, you know, the MD or the singer is not going to object to you turning up with this if the band has a vintage aesthetic going on.
There's no tree of life inlay. It's not too blingy. You've got lovely kind of binding going on and purfling going on here, but it's just the right side of, again, like on the back here, this just running across here, it's classy, isn't it? Rather than blingy.
Classy is the word.
Yeah, but it is interesting. It just goes to show you, this is a slightly cheesy thing to say really, but it just goes to show you, wherever you come into the Martin range, if you can afford this guitar, phenomenal. But actually, if you can't afford this guitar and you come in at this level, actually it's still a very great sounding, very good playing instrument. You know, all the elements are there.
Yeah.
It's just that you can see how things scale up to this point where you've got all of these extra kind of features that make it more consistent, so on and so forth. But you can come in at a reasonable level and get everything you need. You've still got the Martin, you know, logo on the headstock and it plays like a Martin. So, you know, there's something for everybody.
It's agreed. Good. Absolutely. You know, and I wasn't disappointed.
That's the thing.
This, you know, when we said let's swap, I didn't know which guitar Tom had. I assumed it was going to be another one from the same range. When it turned out to be this one, I wasn't unhappy about that. I'm like,
absolutely.
No, it's cool, man. It's a nice guitar. It plays well, feels good. If anything, you know, if I was going to do any lead playing, I'm quite happy doing it on this guitar because of the short scale.
Yep.
You know, but that's just me. You know, one thing I have noticed that Martin do tend to, they tend to ship with a slightly higher action than some of the guitars. And that's a characteristic Martin thing. Of course, you can change that, but it's just part of the guitar. It doesn't make it uncomfortable. But if like me, you're mainly an electric guy, it can be a little bit stiff from time to time. And I think the short scale on this one kind of really offsets that.
That's it. I think a lot of companies, both on the electric and acoustic front, they set their guitars up so that there is absolutely no buzzing anywhere because some people are put off by buzzing. So you're setting the guitar up for a kind of common denominator kind of scenario. But for us, we're kind of, let's face it, shreddy, legato-y, kind
absolutely.
Of light touch guys.
Yeah.
However, having said that, on this guitar, the thin neck profile, you know, the general playability is very, very high indeed. And on this guitar, because you've got the shorter scale length, and as you say, it feels a little bit like the strings are close together. They're probably not, but it's an eminently playable guitar and feels, you know, very, very comfortable under the fingers. So, which again, it's same kind of deal, really. Whichever one you go for, you're getting a good playing experience. You're just scaling up to the budget that fits your particular
absolutely,
you know, abilities in that area, let's
totally
say,
so. Absolutely. So speaking of that, let's wrap up by working out who
absolutely
who's gonna get the most out of each one of these instruments. So let's start with the Dreadnought Junior.
Yep.
Who is this for? I have someone in mind, but I'd be interested to get your thoughts on the subject.
I mean, one thing that springs to mind immediately is this is definitely for the, you know, someone who's gigging regularly but is not kind of, let's say a label or like a you know, a promoter is not paying for instruments for things. You've got to buy this yourself. You don't have a big budget. Mm-hmm. You are gigging regularly and you want something that sounds and plays good, but is also incredibly comfortable to play. So singer-songwriters come to mind where you don't, I don't think this is something you were alluding to before we started this video. For anybody who is going to buy this and is going to immediately start gigging and think, oh my God, if anybody touches this or if I bang it on something or if somebody spills their beer on it, if you can't be that guy, then this instrument is the one to go for, because it's 100%. Still a Martin, it still sounds great, it's still got good playability, you know, but you're not going to be so worried if somebody dings it or spills their pint on it. Or
absolutely, yeah. So it's interesting because we talk about this being a pro-level instrument. This is very much a working level instrument
absolutely.
For me. But the other interesting thing about it is, with it being so small and with it being kind of quite affordable comparatively, it's also, to my mind, it's also a great instrument just for having around the house. You know,
it's true.
You're a recreational player, you can sit on the sofa with this. Mm. We're sitting on a sofa with this. Obviously, you can sit on a sofa with any guitar, but you could sit with your feet up and you could quite happily cradle this. It's so small, you can take it traveling with you.
Yeah.
If you so desire, you know, if you go to a songwriting session or you're just jamming with some mates, it'll fit in the boot of your car.
Absolutely.
You know, you could take it on the bus.
And again, the gig bag is great, as opposed to having, I wouldn't want to put this in a gig bag.
No.
It doesn't come with a gig bag, it comes with a deluxe hard case. That's a big thing to carry around.
It really
is. This comes with a gig bag, it's a small kind of guitar. So again, eminently portable, really, really useful for guys that just want to, as you say, throw something in the back of the car and get on with it.
Definitely. By contrast,
yes.
Who's this for? It's for me, that's who it's for.
Yeah, yeah, really, here you go, Nick, take it with you.
Thank you.
It's yours. This is... You've got to have the budget, obviously. Mm-hmm. So that's the biggest factor, because that's the biggest kind of problem for entry for most people, will be the sheer price of the guitar. I think this really is for somebody who is looking for a few different things. Definitely an instrument that's going to last a long time, and something that they're not just going to kind of play a few times, stick on the wall or whatever. I mean, it's not a bling instrument. So if you want something that looks really nice and you put it on the wall, every now and again you'll pick it up and it's more as a kind of, you know, furniture style instrument that looks really nice. There are more blingy instruments.
You would,
I think,
probably
this
go
is a player's guitar.
Those trophy instruments, you know.
Yeah, trophy instruments.
You would go to the custom shop for that. Not that that's what the custom shop are, you know, exclusively, but if you really want a statement piece.
Exactly.
Absolutely, that's where you go.
And again, you've got to have the budget to do that.
Oh my God, yeah.
But if you've got the budget for a very high-end acoustic guitar that's a pro instrument that really is going to do, you know, a lot of things for you, as a great studio, a great live instrument, and you have the ability to not kind of, you know, you're careful with your instrument and you're going to look after it, then this is a great guitar to go for. I think it's definitely for pros, and if it's not for a pro, it's for somebody who's got the budget to blow on a guitar like this.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to be worrying about money. Because Martin make guitars that, you know, they play really well and they sound great, but don't cost this much money. So you really have to know that if you're going to spend this and stick it on a credit card or buy it, you're not going to be worrying about it for 6 years afterwards, you know.
Yeah. So I would probably argue as well that, you know, the modern features that have really made this guitar such a great kind of pro-level instrument might be lost on people who are maybe looking just for a beautiful Martin to have in the corner of the room and, you know, bash away at. You might be better off going one series down, or maybe even looking at sort of some of the more vintage-inspired instruments that have that more kind of like timeless look.
Absolutely.
Maybe. I mean, by saying that, you know, the more of the aged look, let's say. Obviously, I think this is a very timeless looking instrument.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel like the features and the level of kind of detail that's been put into this, it's the sort of thing that a pro player
Absolutely.
Is really going to get the most out
yep.
of. It strikes me as the sort of thing you would probably keep as a studio instrument.
Me too.
Or if you were touring on a very... in a very big production, you know, where your instruments are safely kept away from, you know, from all and sundry, maybe they're locked away in a you know, kind of like a road case.
Exactly.
And they only come out and they're handled by you and your tech if you're lucky enough to have one. You know, but definitely for the studio, because it sounds phenomenal
Absolutely.
In so many styles, you know. Yep. It amazed me how well it handles just about everything. You know, people talk about different acoustic guitar body types being good for different things. You would assume that a smaller body like this wouldn't be great for kind of bashing on like a dreadnought, it handles it really well.
Absolutely.
Definitely a pro level instrument. I totally agree.
It's not a workhorse in the same way that is, although it could be a workhorse, it could do anything.
It's a workhorse.
It wants to be treated well at the same time.
Yeah,
you want to look after
absolutely.
It and, you know, prize this kind of an instrument. So,
maybe it's not for me then.
You've
seen the state of my guitars. So maybe it's
not for me. I take headstock chips out and all sorts. So.
Yeah, maybe not in that case.
I'm going to put it back in the case very carefully.
Yeah, very, very gently. I'm not going to. I'm going to put this one in gently as well.
Throw that one in.
Only because it's not mine. If it was mine, it would get thrown in the back of the car.
Exactly.
But anyway, guys, this has been a little bit of a look at two fabulous Martin guitars. Of course, you can check out the reviews in the magazine. Make sure you go and look at those for kind of a deeper look at each one of these instruments. My name's Nick Jennison, sat with Tom Quayle. We'll see you next time.
Cheers, guys. See you later.